adjusted here. Good afternoon, or good morning, good afternoon. I think it's the afternoon. How's everyone? Can you hear us all right? Very good. Welcome to Eyeless in Gaza. Possibly the 1,000th panel on Gaza to bear this name. I am Jonathan Shainin. I am joined on stage by Molly Crabapple, just to my left, who is a writer and artist from New York, who's reported from Gaza, is the author of a new book, Drawing Blood, available at all good bookstores, including the one in there. To Molly's left is Omar Barghouti. Omar is a human rights activist and the co-founder of the BDS movement. And all the way down at the left is Laleh, who is a professor at SOAS in London, is the author of two books, Heroes and Martyrs of Palestine, The Politics of National Commemoration, and more recently, Time in the Shadows, Confinement in Counterinsurgencies, both of which are very relevant to our subject here today. The history of Gaza goes back an awfully long time, and I won't bore you with all of it, but it's believed that this area was inhabited as long as 4,000 or 5,000 years ago. It was controlled for a time by Egyptians. It was besieged and captured by Alexander the Great in 332 BCE. Later on, it came under the control of the Israelites. It was conquered and rebuilt by Romans. It was conquered again by Arab armies. It was contested by the Crusaders, who were themselves driven out by Saladin. It came under British control after World War I. And then in 1948, it became a place of refuge for roughly one quarter of the 800,000 Palestinians who were expelled from what was then mandatory Palestine. In 1949, shortly thereafter, it became it was administered by Egypt. In 1967, it was taken again by Israel, and since then, it has been controlled by Israel. It was the place where, I hope I've got this right, the sort of the first intifada in the 1980s began. It's been a sort of hotbed of Palestinian nationalism. After the Oslo Accords in 1993, it became the headquarters of the new Palestinian Authority, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Bringing us up to the present, where since 2007, when the Hamas government ejected Fatah, it has come under siege from Israel, and it has been essentially blockaded. Since that takeover in 2007, it has been the site of three wars, each one increasingly destructive in 2008, 2012, and 2014. Without going too much further into the history of it, I want to turn things to Molly, who took a reporting trip to Gaza last year, roughly about 1 year after the last war ended. And I thought Molly could tell us about how she got there, what it was like getting inside, and what she saw while she was there. So Molly Crabapple.
Thank you so much. I'm so happy to speak about this, and also I'm such an honor to be on a panel with Omar Barghouti and Laleh, amazing co-panelists, and with you, Jonathan. I was in Gaza last June to report for Vice about Shujaiya, which is a neighborhood near the border of Israel that was completely destroyed during Israel's invasion of the Strip during Operation Protective Edge. Now, Gaza is under a blockade. This means that the amount of goods that get into Gaza are severely, severely limited. It means that there aren't enough construction supplies to rebuild after the war. It means that a Gazan student can't go abroad to study, or someone who needs medical treatment in Egypt will not be able to cross the border to get that. It also means that it's very difficult for people to visit Gaza. As a journalist, I had to seek permission both from the Israeli government and also from Hamas. Now, to visit Gaza is an intensely illuminating experience in terms of the confinement that Palestinians suffer. First, you go to something called the Eretz Crossing, which is this massive, massive, almost airline hangar of a place that was built by the Israelis back when Gazans frequently worked in Israel. And it's completely, completely empty. You go through a quite rigorous security check from the Israelis, and then you walk through these cages. And cages are something that you will see over and over again in Palestine, whether it's the cages of the Qalandiyya checkpoint that separates Ramallah from Jerusalem, or whether it's these cages that I walked through. And you walk through the cages. Then you go to a checkpoint by the Palestinian Authority. And then once you cross that, you go through a checkpoint with Hamas. Now, Gaza is a place that is both brutalized and besieged, but also is a place that, I don't know how to describe it. I want to say, like, the living spirit of resistance, like a middle finger raised to a much, to an infinitely stronger power that still can't break it. In Shujaiya, which is one of the neighborhoods that was destroyed during Operation Protective Edge, I remember painted on the rubble of a destroyed building, "I love Gaza." So Operation Protective Edge was a war started by the Israelis under the pretext that Hamas was involved in the kidnapping of two teenagers in Hebron, something that turned out to be entirely untrue. However, it doesn't matter because Hamas is used as a pretext for all sorts of Israeli incursions onto the Strip. When I was there, a group that was allegedly affiliated with ISIS shot rockets off into a field in Israel. And in retaliation, Israel shelled Hamas facilities, despite the fact that they had nothing to do with it. Operation Protective Edge was a war of intense brutality. 2,100 people were killed. Allegedly, 70% of them were civilians, 500 of them were kids. It was also a war that destroyed 18,000 homes. It left 108,000 Gazans displaced. And Gaza is a tiny place. You know, it's 25 miles long, 3.5 miles to 7.5 miles wide. You know, it's a tiny, tiny place that people are confined within. It also destroyed infrastructure. It destroyed, you know, hospitals. It destroyed the Ministry of Health. It destroyed sewage processing facilities. It destroyed the power plant for a while, and, you know, parts of it couldn't be rebuilt. Every single military incursion into the Strip leads to further destruction of the Palestinian economy and further destruction of Palestinians' inability to support it themselves, thus taking something that was a political problem, that was a political issue of people trying to assert their rights, and changing it into a humanitarian crisis, which can thus be depoliticized.
Can I get you to talk for a bit about the people you met when you were there? So Molly's article, which was published in Vice, which is called Shujaiya Dust, as many of you probably know from having seen Molly on panels before, Molly is an artist and a writer, and so you've drawn the people who you've met. Can you just talk a bit about some of the conversations you had with people when you were there? You went to this neighborhood, Shujaiya, which was almost entirely destroyed, and what kind of things did people there say to you? And what is it like for them when someone comes in like you, a journalist, comes in from outside, presumably they're not seeing a lot of visitors?
So people were living in their abandoned, in their bombed out homes in Shujaiya, very often in tents, sometimes in caravans next to their homes, but often just in the bombed houses. I was so warmed by the hospitality that people had to me. I mean, you know, here I am, I'm a foreigner, I'm a journalist, and we all know that journalism is an essentially vampiric trade, and I'm showing up at their homes, and people were intensely willing to tell their stories. What I got from many people I spoke to is just this sense of, like, why are we being collectively punished? We didn't shoot off the rockets, you know, we just live here, and yet, we just want to work, we just want to have a job, and yet, you know, tanks drove into our neighborhood, shot holes in our walls, wrote racist graffiti on them, you know, bulldozed our trees, and, you know, there's nothing that we can do about it. It's just this anguish at collective punishment. A lot of people told me, like, we don't, you know, just want peace for, you know, 1 year, 2 years, until another war starts, want peace for forever.
I want to turn to Laleh now, and your new book, Time in the Shadows, looks at the idea that confinement, whether that's, you know, prisons or walls, has become a kind of defining aspect, I suppose, of contemporary warfare. I mean, you say liberal counterinsurgencies, but the sorts of wars that modern states now fight, the use of this idea of confining people, whether it's in Guantanamo Bay, which I think is one of your examples, or whether it's building broader walls. You know, you could even look at the U.S. In Baghdad, you know, putting walls up to divide Sunni from Shiite populations. Can you talk a bit, before we even come to Gaza, about how this strategy of confinement has evolved and what it is that makes it so distinctive about modern warfare?
First of all, can I just say this is the most thrilling thing I have ever attended, and it's really amazing to see such incredibly engaged and incisive audiences. I gotta say, you guys are amazing. But to actually start talking about counterinsurgencies, one of the things that I've been most struck by, and I do think it's not just modern warfare, I think it's a particular brand of warfare waged by countries that claim to follow the rule of law. And so they cannot, because of this claim, they cannot openly engage in unrestrained mass slaughter. Or if they do, they have to dress it up in something. And that something often is a kind of a legal retaliation, the discourse of retaliation, or collateral damage. In those instances, what you end up getting are policies of confinement, policies of siege, forced starvation, control of populations, massive use of intelligence against these populations, massive control of their movements, and ever more increasing surveillance and coercion against populations that are maintained in ever more shrinking areas that can be gridded, surveilled, attacked from above, etc. And so I think that you see that actually in a lot of liberal counterinsurgencies. Illiberal regimes, Russia and Chechnya, Syria in its own country, tend to just go out there and bomb.
They just bulldoze right in, right.
Whereas liberal regimes that claim to be following international law tend to have this policy of confinement as a way to pacify civilian populations. And I think that that's really, really crucial.
And you would define confinement as any regime that's controlling movement, whether through security, checkpoints kind of thing, or through literally building walls.
And I think that in some senses, Israeli policy in Gaza has been absolutely the perfect example of this. I think it's really important to remember that the massive apartheid walls that are being built in to separate West Bank from the inside in Israel-Palestine were first, in some senses, road tested in Gaza in the 1950s and 60s, sorry, in the 1970s by Sharon. And so there was a sense in which these walls were being actually thought about as a method of control by Sharon in the 1970s. The other thing that is really, really important is the way in which Israel has been using a policy of starvation. And I'm not talking about this being a collateral or side effect. They actually had memos in which they counted the minimum number of calories needed for children, women, and men in order for them not to starve. And that kind of a memo was actually one that they had issued within the regime of occupation as a way of maintaining what food was allowed into Gaza and was not allowed. And some of the food that was not allowed were actually part of regular cooking, and I'm not sure they even counted as calories. So, for example, coriander was banned from entry. I'm sure that can be used in dual use for something, but God knows what the second usage would be. In addition to that, drones, which are now a complete feature of this kind of warfare from above, warfare and surveillance from above, assassination, were first field tested in Gaza. There's a whole series of different ways of enclosure and shrinking of space. For example, there are free fire zones that essentially surround the entirety of Gaza and into the sea, so that if you cross into it and you're a Palestinian, regardless of what it is that you're doing, if you're a shepherd, for example, grazing your sheep, or if you're a farmer trying to tend to your land, or if you're a fisher person trying to go out and fish, if you enter those free fire zones, you're fair game for the Israeli military. And what is interesting about this is, of course, that these sets of processes, Israel actually used initially on the population that are now citizens of Israel up to 1966 when they were under military administration. Later, between 1967 and now, in the West Bank, and of course Gaza, as I said, is the sort of the exemplary method of this. And of course they benefit from this in economic senses as well. Some of the richest sources of natural gas have been discovered in Gaza's water just off the coast. In addition to that, Israel actually transforms all of the methods, all of the different technologies that it has road tested in Gaza, which Gaza acts as a kind of a laboratory, including
including things like biometrics, drones, methods of warfare, doctrines of control and pacification, and actually sells it as a kind of a manual of counterinsurgency to all sorts of regimes all around the world, everywhere from Indonesia to Colombia.
Leila, let me ask you, when we're talking about what is the strategic logic of this kind of confinement, right? So I think, look, the rest of the world looks at what's happening here. In some cases, they see a conflict between Hamas on the one side and Israel on the other side. You have this population, I should have said this at the beginning, it's 1.8 million people, I believe, confined to a very small territory. What's the logic of that, right? You think to a degree from a strategic perspective, this is certain to backfire, right? You're penning these people in, they're not allowed to live. It's going to where they're not allowed to sort of thrive, I suppose. And this is going to be something that is going to attract the attention of the rest of the world in a very negative way, which we'll come to in a moment. Within these counterinsurgency campaigns, as you describe them, what is the logic of confinement, right? If you went into a meeting of generals somewhere and you said, wait, hang on, what's going on here? Why should we keep these people in here? What would they say?
Okay, well, I think that there's in the Gazan kind and Israeli form of counterinsurgency in particular, there are several logics that are in operation which all feed into each other. There's a long-term underlying logic, which is the logic of settler colonialism. And it goes back to the Iron Wall policy that was essentially can be traced back to Zev Jabotinsky, who was the sort of founding father of what is now Likud, in a sense, which was that what you do is the only way in which you can produce a docile population is by having an iron wall of bayonets supporting them. I'm almost directly quoting from Jabotinsky's writing in the 1920s. And it is when you have made this population completely hopeless about their national aspirations is when you actually get to win. It's when you actually get them to submit.
So the logic of confinement here is that you produce a willingness to compromise from your opponents because...
But there's also something very specific about Gaza, and that is that Gaza has had a very long history of resistance in a whole series of forms. The PFLP, which was a Marxist-Leninist organization, those of you who are familiar with the 1960s and 70s probably remember PFLP, had actually one of its strongest presences in Palestine proper in Gaza. As you said, the first Intifada began in Gaza. This is a population that has had a long history of armed resistance, but it has also had a long history of attacks by Israel. One of the moments that is forgotten, for example, is that in 1956, during the Israeli collaboration with the British and the French in going against Nasser, one of the largest scale massacres that has happened at the hand of Israel actually happened in Gaza. It's a story that even historians of Palestine don't know much about. And there's actually a really great book by Joe Sacco, a colleague of you in illustration, which
footsteps
has been written
Gaza.
About this.
This is Footsteps in Gaza, isn't it?
It is. And so I think it's important to remember that there are immediate reasons that the generals cite, which is that there is this intransigent population that cannot be made to submit. And then there's, of course, the underlying logic of settler colonialism.
So I want to turn to Omar here. Omar, you're the co-founder of the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions Movement, which is, I think, fair to describe as an international protest movement against the Israeli occupation. What, in your experience, before we get into BDS properly, has been the kind of global response to these wars in Gaza, and maybe specifically the last one?
I think after the last Israeli massacre in the summer of 2014, the main response was that we have to make Israel pay a very heavy price, because this was a televised massacre. People could see it on TV.
And was it in that way different than the previous wars?
It was worse, at a much higher scale, and Israel was getting away with it, showing that everything we've done was not enough to hold Israel's impunity in check. So the reason, I'll connect to what Laleh said, hopelessness is a key weapon used in colonizing the minds of the oppressed. And Israel is doing it in the worst case scenario in Gaza, to really colonize people's minds by inducing hopelessness. One of the ways to fight hopelessness is to empower people and show them that there is effective solidarity with them around the world. So as opposed to 10 years ago, people did not just go down on the streets, whether in India, Britain, South Africa, Brazil, or the United States, just chanting against Israel's massacre. They did something much more effective about it, which is boycott, divestments, and sanction. This is why BDS has grown tremendously after the last massacre in Gaza.
I suppose what I'm getting towards here is this idea that even from an Israeli perspective, this is a counterproductive action. Right, from Israel's perspective, they are saying, okay, we have to do this war in Gaza. We're threatened by missiles that are being fired from Gazan territory. And yet what's happening is that this is providing more global support for a protest movement against Israel.
You're assuming a certain rational level in the Israeli establishment's mentality that does not exist.
Right.
I mean, we have to admit, part of the reason...
Oh, I think everyone here is familiar with how this government works as well.
Part of the reason why BDS has succeeded, is growing so tremendously, we've got to give credit where credit belongs, to the far-right shift in Israel. Without Netanyahu, we couldn't have done it this fast. So the right, the extreme right in Israel, the fanatic right, the fundamentalists, the settlers, are so irrational that they shoot themselves in the foot over and over without realizing it. So indeed, by doing this last massacre in Gaza, they helped the BDS movement grow tremendously. And now it's not just in the United Kingdom where you naturally suppose people support Palestinian rights, or South Africa or Brazil, it's in the United States where it's growing the fastest.
So you're someone, you live in the West Bank, you obviously are paying very close attention to what's happening in kind of Israeli public discourse. What is the way that, you know, let's say before this 2014 war, or even since then, what is the Israeli public perception of Gaza, right? If you pick up one of the big Israeli newspapers, or you turn on the television, what is the sense of Gaza that is presented to the Israeli public? And I suspect it's different than the sense of what the West Bank as it's presented.
Yeah. Well, the anti-Arab racism in Israel is very mainstream. And it's not hidden. There's no political correctness whatsoever in Israel. They openly express racism against Arabs, especially in Gaza.
So you're saying more so in Gaza than in the West
Absolutely,
Bank.
Absolutely. If Israelis are dehumanizing Palestinians, that reaches the extremes in Gaza, where Palestinians in Gaza are totally dehumanized in the Israeli mind and the Israeli perception. And I'm not talking about the far right as in fringes, I'm talking about the mainstream, but in academia, in arts, and so on.
Why Gaza more so than the West Bank?
Because Gaza has been very troublesome for Israel.
Okay.
Resistance in Gaza has been particularly accentuated. They want to get rid of Gaza. From Yitzhak Rabin onwards, they said, we hope we can wake up one day and see Gaza just drown in the Mediterranean. They want to get rid of 1.8 million Palestinians. They want to see them drown in the Mediterranean.
Well, there is, right. You sometimes hear hopes expressed that Gaza might somehow become part of Egypt.
And they've expressed that as well. They said, resettle the Gaza refugees in Sinai, rather than return them to the villages and towns from which they were expelled during the 1948 Nakba, the ethnic cleansing of Palestine.
I want to say one thing about that becoming part of Egypt. That used to be a major discourse, but ever since they've discovered gas off the coast of Gaza,
that's no longer,
because of the particular ways in which sovereign states can actually make a claim to so much land, so much sort of sea territory as economic zone, they have stopped talking about Gaza becoming part of Egypt because they're afraid of Egypt getting its hand on that gas reserve.
So I wanted to ask you, Laleh, to talk about the history of Gaza, I guess, a bit, in terms of, you know, your first book was about refugee camps in Lebanon, but you were looking at this idea of the kind of iconography of a national movement that also fashions itself as a resistance movement. And as we said before, this has been very much what Gaza has represented in some way in the Palestinian imagination. Can you talk a bit about that, you know, the time between 1948 and maybe the end of the last century, 1993, what was happening in Gaza, what life was like for refugees who moved there, things of that sort.
I think you should jump
maybe
in
Omar
on this
can,
anytime you want. I mean, what is interesting is, of course, that between 1948 and 1967, Gaza was under Egyptian administration. And but even then, Gaza always presented itself as a kind of a troublesome place, even to Egyptians. And again, part of the reason for that was because it was a place full of ferment. This was a place in which people got together, perhaps because of the extraordinary presence of loads of refugees who actually came there from some of the metropolitan cities. I mean, the Yafawis, for example, people from Jaffa, had a very large presence in the population of Gaza, refugees in Gaza. And so there was a huge amount of ferment of resistance that even then the Egyptian administration wanted to control and channel, and it found it difficult. So it's interesting to read some of the memoirs of some of the people who later on became the leaders of PLO, write about their early years in Gaza, and talk about the amount of harassment they got from the Egyptian police, for example. So there's this particularly interesting history, which is very unique to Gaza, and which makes it very distinctive than, for example, the claims that it's just some little slip of land that is sticking off of Egypt into the belly of Israel. After 1967, as I mentioned earlier, it became a laboratory for the exercise of various kinds of military policies of military pacification and political administration. And throughout that period, in the 1950s, 1960s, 1970s, there was an entire history of various kinds of political movements. Initially, when Arab nationalist and pan-Arabist movements were very, very prevalent in the 1950s and 1960s, those groups were also, with very strong Palestinian flavor, but those groups were also very present in Gaza. But with the emergence of the PLO actually had a massive foothold in Gaza. It had an extraordinary presence there, and in fact, the emergence of Fatah, PFLP, and some of these other groups that were part of the umbrella group of PLO ended up becoming quite an interesting thorn in Israeli side, because they really wanted to control that. They really wanted to root out these radical movements, because they were very worried about the kind of problems that they were going to cause.
And it's to Gaza, of course, where the PLO returned after the Oslo Accord. So when Arafat comes back from Tunisia, it's Gaza where?
Jericho and Gaza, yeah. The solution was supposed to be Jericho and Gaza, again, partially because Gaza was always considered to be a place that, particularly after 1979, Camp David Accords, where Egypt and Israel became essentially allies, where Israel could be certain of Gaza being insulated in some sense.
Because there was the Egyptian.
Exactly.
I want to turn here, you know, we're sitting here, I realize, as you talk about the sort of the movement of these refugees into Gaza in huge numbers. I mean, it's sort of, I read somewhere yesterday that you had 25% of the Palestinian population has moved onto 1% of the land. And I'm thinking we're here in India, this is a country, and, you know, I suspect if I asked the audience to raise their hands, which I won't, you know, in terms of whether your families had moved during partition, we would get a lot of hands up in the air. So, you know, we're in a place that is familiar very much with this sort of movement of people under war and the sort of politics of refugees. And Molly, you have been doing for the past several years now quite a lot of work on not just this conflict, but on refugees from other conflicts. Particularly the war in Syria, which I think in a way, I mean, I don't know if this is even quite right, but has in some sense displaced attention from the situation in Gaza. I wonder, Molly, if you could talk a bit, you know, about your experience in and around Syria, on the Syria-Turkish border, in refugee camps, and the commonalities that you see between these two situations.
I've been reporting on the Syrian refugee crisis for the last 2 years. I've visited camps in Iraqi Kurdistan, in Syria, just inside the border, the Bab el-Salem camp. I've visited camps in Lebanon, in Turkey, and I've also spent a lot of time and, you know, have many friends who are Syrian refugees. In some ways, and it's not a precise analogy, but analogies never are, in some ways, the mass displacement caused by the Syrian war does resemble a second Nakba. People are fleeing from all sides of the Syrian conflict. They're fleeing from the Assad government, they're fleeing from bombings, they're fleeing from poverty, they're fleeing from crimes carried out by rebel groups and by ISIS or by the YPG, but the majority are fleeing from the government. When you go into a camp in the Bekaa Valley,
This
is in Lebanon. Syrians were forbidden from creating permanent camps for themselves, in large part because of internal Lebanese politics around Palestinian refugees. And so Syrians would rent land that no one wanted, you know, just plots of land you can't grow anything on. And they would put up tents. They would be very often being overcharged by local Lebanese landholders. And they would just run through their savings waiting for the war to be over. I met people who were burning plastic bags for heat, and it's not because they don't know that plastic bags are bad for your lungs, it's just there's nothing else. You saw people with college degrees begging for work as day laborers on the side of the street, and being paid much less because they're Syrians. In Turkey, which in some ways is perhaps the best on the countrywide scale to most Syrian refugees, as long as you're not Kurdish, you still see people working for $200 a month in sweatshops, you know. And it's funny because one of the things about the Syrian refugee crisis and how it's perceived in the West is that in the West there's most of the attention is focused on refugees that are taking these boats from Turkey to Greece and then walking from Greece to Germany. And what's sometimes not acknowledged in America and in the West is that these people are actually, sadly to say, the best off, because these are all the people who can pay a smuggler $2,000 per person to get into a life raft.
And they're, relatively speaking, a minority of the overall refugee population.
They're a minority.
There are millions and millions of people.
There are people who are both internally displaced inside Syria and also people who are, in the neighboring countries. I know people who have family members that actually stayed in ISIS territories simply because they were poor farmers and they couldn't afford to get off their land, but also because they were like, these people are occupiers. I'm not going to leave my home, and they should be the ones to leave.
And do you feel, when you write these pieces, do you feel like there is a consciousness that people come to have about this refugee experience? Or is this just something that, an audience in the West is never going to really understand? It's going to be seen as a kind of distant tragedy. Maybe you donate some money every now and again. How do you feel that people react to kind of seeing very vivid portrayals of just how wretched life is for these people who are forced into leaving the Syrian war?
Oh God, it's hard to make a universal judgment about all viewers in the West. I think it depends if you had family that were refugees. Because you have to remember, many Americans, from a wide variety of backgrounds have had families that were refugees. One thing that was actually quite positive was, many people in the Jewish community in America, and I'm half Jewish myself, saw a lot of commonality between the ways that European countries were attempting to shut their doors to Syrian refugees and the ways that European countries shut their doors to Jews that were fleeing the Holocaust, or the ways that America shut its doors to Jews that were fleeing the Holocaust. And there has been some solidarity from the, or a lot of solidarity from the American Jewish community and from a number of other communities. And one thing I do want to note is that Syrian refugees and Palestinian refugees, it's actually in some ways a misnomer to separate them so neatly. There's a huge population of Palestinian refugees living in Syria.
Right, who have become sort of refugees twice over.
Exactly, and who don't even have the slim margin of legal protection that a Syrian citizen would have. I mean, Yarmouk, which was sort of the cultural heart of the Palestinian diaspora in Syria, was under a starvation siege and now only has a few thousand people living in it. So I think...
And was sort of besieged, if I recall correctly, by both rebel groups and by Assad.
It was mostly besieged by Assad, but then ISIS went into Yarmouk and Jabhat al-Nusra was also there and executed.
But there's one thing about refugees and solidarity versus charity, and we were discussing that. If you're just a victim, at best you attract charity, sympathy. But if you're resisting, you attract solidarity, effective solidarity. And that's exactly what Palestine refugees, especially in Gaza, but not just in Gaza, are doing. First, Israel is trying to incarcerate their ambitions and their dreams, that you cannot dream of returning to the homeland from which you were expelled. At best, relaxation of the siege, maybe lifting the siege eventually. So they're trying to lower the ceiling of our ambitions. So what we're trying to do in the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement is no, we want the full menu of rights, as Desmond Tutu would say. The full menu of rights.
When Molly was talking, I was thinking of asking you, when these subjects are debated, there is often the kind of invocation, it was a sort of question of history, right? It is often said, this is a refugee crisis that was created a very long time ago. We, the people of the present, have nothing to do with it. What do you say to someone who says, look, this is all old news. There was a war that was fought, and that's very tough. Bad things happen in war. But, now it's 70 years later. What are we going to do about it?
It's funny. Some of the same people saying that Palestinians should forget what happened 67 years ago are the same people who are saying Jews were expelled from Palestine 2,000 years ago. The hypocrisy has no limit.
You can always go further and further and further back.
But regardless of whether we agree fully on the history or not, what the facts are, Palestinians are under occupation, under a system of apartheid, and most of us are refugees who are not allowed to go home. These are rights under international law. So if we forget the different narratives and so on, if there's one semi-objective reality out there, it's the United Nations international law, which we have to resort to resolve this issue. But international law says refugees have a right to return, people have a right to live without occupation, and people definitely have a right to live without apartheid. This is exactly the slogan we raised in the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement. Freedom, justice, and equality means ending the occupation, ending apartheid, and the right of return. So we're not circumscribing our dreams, our ambitions.
And you're not saying this is simply a matter of historical reconciliation?
No, it's not. It's our rights now, in 2016, regardless whether we fully agree or not what happened in 1948. Those are our rights now, and we shall not compromise on our basic rights under international law. And we're not asking for charity.
I want to ask Laleh to talk here about, you know, because I think Omar is, you know, at the center of the storm here. In your view, what is it that makes this current protest movement different and, it would seem to me, more effective than previous such movements related to Palestinian rights?
I wouldn't say, okay, so I do think that BDS is particularly effective. And one of the reasons that I think it's particularly effective is precisely because it rejects a discourse of victimhood, it appeals to international solidarity, and it is one that has carefully thought through all the different questions that could be thrown at it. It is not around questions of ethnic or religious difference. It is around the question of right to self-determination, right, various sets
and
of human rights.
Complicity rather than identity.
Exactly.
We're not targeting Israel based on any identity, but based on its involvement in denying our rights. Any corporation, any university involved in that system of denial of rights, we shall target, regardless of its identity.
But I have to say there's another component to it, which makes me doubt this statement that this is much more successful than previous movements. Because I think having studied Palestinian movement in the 1960s and 70s, when Palestinian nationalism was situated firmly within a third worldist, often lefty, often quite radical, transformative, anti-colonial moment. That is the moment in which Palestine came actually to the attention of the world.
Sort of international attention.
By everybody from Amilcar Cabral to the ANC, to the Communist Parties of Africa, to Che Guevara himself, talking about Palestine as a global issue of solidarity, as an anti-colonial moment, as a place where you actually fought for not just your own little identity group, but for a kind of a global anti-colonial sentiment. And I think that that's why it's important to remember that history as well, because I think in some senses, although that was a moment of armed resistance, etc., the sentiments of global solidarity are much more proximate to today's BDS than the methods are, of course.
Omar, do you want to follow up there?
Sure. The point is how
I'll pose a question here, which is that Laleh has talked about this sort of era of armed resistance, which I think, for various reasons, would be a difficult thing to get global support for today.
To say the least.
Yes. So, you know, there was a different kind of protest going on, and I think it's one safe to say, and maybe you can talk about this, that Israel finds particularly threatening. So it is not uncommon to hear people say, inside and outside of Israel, well, this is a threat to our very existence.
Absolutely.
This is a campaign to delegitimize us.
Yeah.
You know, how do you take up people saying things like that?
Well, first, Israel today, the establishment, says BDS is a strategic threat that can develop into an existential threat. And so that connects with the issue that BDS, the Boycott, Divestment, Sanctions movement, is trying to destroy Israel. My immediate response, if equality, justice, and freedom would destroy Israel, what does that say about Israel? I mean, this is obvious.
This is in a way the logic of the campaign.
But the second issue is how to involve anthropologists in the United States, trade unionists in Britain, farmers in South Africa, and so on, and so, progressives in India, and so on and so forth, in the solidarity movement. With armed resistance, we were very limited. Support for armed resistance could be at best symbolic.
Right.
But now, with BDS, people can do something about it. Don't just go out in a demonstration and burn Israel's flag. That's not enough. It won't cut it. anthropologists in the US are endorsing an academic boycott of Israel's universities. Trade unions are endorsing a boycott of Israeli products, and so on and so forth.
And do you see, my sense is that what has been most controversial about the BDS movement has been these academic and cultural boycotts. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's more threatening, of course, to boycott a company that's going to go and do business there. But what has, in the international media, and particularly in America, earned a lot of criticism has been the idea of boycotting an individual person or boycotting a cultural worker or something like that. Is that something where you risk a backlash?
No, it's absolutely based on false premises. It's because Israel's media influence is enormous in the United States. They can spread those lies. Unlike the South African academic and cultural boycott, which I was personally part of in my school days in New York, the Palestinian call for the academic and cultural boycott of Israel, which is part of BDS, does not target Israeli individuals.
They're not individuals themselves.
It's an institutional boycott. Right. We do not target cultural workers or academics as individuals. We target their institutions because their institutions are so deeply implicated in the system of apartheid and colonization. So we can prove the complicity with institutions. But someone might say, why aren't you targeting individuals? Are you saying that Israeli academics and cultural workers are progressive and they should not be boycotted? Absolutely not. They're like the rest of Israeli society, extremely racist. They should definitely be boycotted by individuals who care to do so.
But we're
not boycotting them because we do not want to fall into a McCarthyist trap. Having lists, blacklists, who's a good Israeli, who's a bad Israeli. We don't do that.
Yeah.
Of course, just one last point. We have partners who are Israeli, Jewish Israeli, in the BDS movement. And that's a very important factor that's terrifying Israel. They cannot nicely break out this dichotomy, the Jews versus the rest. We have so many Jewish activists in the BDS movement, especially in the United States, and increasingly within Israel, we have Jewish support for BDS. So that's shattering this dichotomy, this binary.
I also have to make a flippant comment and say, the BDS, being involved in BDS and being signed up to it, is probably the first time in my life that I've actually felt powerful as an academic. We're often dismissed as being completely irrelevant to anything. And suddenly, as soon as you sign to BDS, you start getting these emails, threatening emails, about how you're going to destroy an entire state. It's like, whoa, power, man. Never thought I had that much.
I want to turn to Molly and you know, trying to leave things on a hopeful note. For you to talk about when you were last in Gaza, when you were there last year, what were the hopes of the people who were living there, who you talked to? You know, what is their vision of what a good future could be for them?
Ending the siege on Gaza, giving Gazans free movement, not bombing them every 2 years and destroying their homes and infrastructure.
Do they have hope that that's going to happen?
I'd say they had, the people I interviewed had wishes, which is different than hopes. But I think that the first thing that everyone I spoke to wanted to talk about was ending the siege so that people could, you know, get the material goods that they need to have a decent life and also travel freely.
Well, I'll give you an example where there was a lot of hope in Gaza. When dock workers in Cochin, India, and Oakland, California, decided to prevent Israeli ships from offloading in their ports, this gave enormous, in 2009, this gave enormous hope to people on the ground in Gaza that, oh, we're not forgotten, we're not alone.
So you're saying it's international solidarity that brings
hope. Absolutely.
All right, I'm going to turn it to the crowd now for some questions. I suspect there may be many, many of them. Everyone has been remarkably quiet and listening very attentively. I am going to point to people. How about the woman there with the glasses?
Hey.
Hi, hello.
Try and keep it short.
First of all, thank you so much for a lovely talk. It takes me back to my days in Laleh's classroom, actually. I was at SOAS just so very recently, so this is something very close to my heart. I have two questions, kind of. One, which is a very broad one. At the current rate that we're going at, what do you think is the future of Gaza and the broader Palestinian state in the years to come politically? And from that, how can we as a global community, for example, at SOAS, we're big proponents of the BDS movement, the Israel-Palestine issue is always something that's very close to our heart. What can we as a broader community do to kind of show our solidarity for the resistance movement?
Why don't you answer that?
We should stick to the first question,
okay.
Because I think we could do both, but you know.
Why don't you answer that, the future of Gaza? Iranian shouldn't speak about the future of Gaza.
We might be good human rights activists, but we're not prophets. So we cannot guess what might happen. Things are very bleak, and they're not getting much better. We need much more international effective solidarity in order to raise the level of the price that Israel must pay for its crimes in Gaza. With the siege continuing, with counting calories and so on, as was mentioned, we've got to stop this cycle and to give people hope, to empower people to continue to resist and to steadfast. So we need much more solidarity to break this cycle.
And I think it is bleak. The situation is often bleak. But having lived through the Iranian Revolution and having studied the uprisings of 2011, often movements emerge at moments when you least expect it. So yes, I completely agree that we're not prophets, but the one thing that I'm sure of is change will come in one form or another.
All right, who wants to come next? There's a guy there wearing a jacket. Very hard to figure out how to, second row, there you are.
Hello, my question is to Omar. Sir, how much of a threat do you think is the Anti-Defamation League to your BDS movement? And also, do you think there are chances of reconciliation between the Hamas and the Fatah because they're always fighting? And
this is a very good question, which I meant to ask. So why don't we begin with that? What is the? Give us a brief pressy of the Hamas-Fatah situation.
Oh, that's so depressing. well, currently there aren't many positive signs to speak of, but there's enormous public pressure on both. That we need unity, Palestinian unity, in order to resist properly. But it's not just an internal Palestinian issue, it certainly is, but it's also an external issue. There's so many players, from the United States to Israel, obviously, to the European Union, and Iran, and many others, that are playing a role in this divisiveness that we have. But certainly, there's pressure to get...
And can I just say on that, as long as the Palestinian Authority acts like a security subcontractor for Israel, I suspect that it's going to be very hard for them to reconcile with anybody else within the Israel-Palestine.
Yeah, the point is to distinguish between Fatah as a party and the Palestinian Authority as a subcontractor for the occupier, basically. On the first question, on the Anti-Defamation League, I'm afraid many people might not know what that is. It's one of the main groups doing lobbying for Israel. The main accusation used...
Before we go further, there's a broad anti-BDS campaign.
Yes. So it's based on the anti-Semitism charge. To put it in a nutshell, the mainstay of that lobby's attack on BDS is that since Israel is a Jewish state and BDS calls for a boycott of Israel, therefore it's anti-Semitic by definition. Our main response is, well, who says Israel should be synonymous with all Jews? Israel does not speak for all Jewish populations around the world. It does not represent all Jews. And in fact, claiming that is anti-Semitic. Putting all Jews in one basket is very anti-Semitic, whether it's Israel or not.
All right, let's take the next question. I see a guy there holding a program up in the air.
Good afternoon. I have one question. Don't you see a change in India's position towards
yes.
Palestine
yes.
from the days of Indira Gandhi, then moving into what was the Vajpayee era.
Got it.
And Mr. Modi, who only looks at business.
You want to start?
No, you start.
Absolutely. We really miss Indira Gandhi.
No!
There may not be a popular sentiment here. I think in a way, though, this connects to what Laleh was saying, which is that there was a time when the issue of Palestine was part of a global third worldist anti-colonial sort of zeitgeist in which India under Nehru and Shastri and Indira Gandhi participated. And this is now...
Well, one of the things I'm going to cite also one of my wonderful PhD students. I'm not going to name her. She may not want to be named in such a big audience. She is working on... She started off by a comparison between right-wing RSS-related women's movements here in India and women's settler movements in Israel. And she originally was just going to compare methods, discourses, the ways in which gender was mobilized by them. She went off and did research in both groups, She came back, and what she was really struck by was not only a comparative similarity, but connections. These guys apparently connected on Twitter, they corresponded with one another, they exchanged methods, they exchanged discourses, and so much the same way that there was in the 1960s a left-wing global movement of solidarity, here in the 21st century, we've got a kind of a terrifying right-wing movement of solidarity across the world, where all those quasi-fascist groups are, you know, hand in hand and exchanging information and knowledge. And that is something that we need to recognize and I think be very aware of, because these movements are not isolated to their own countries. They do have support from outside.
Another issue is the intersectionality of struggles. One can ask, why should Indians really care about Gaza or Palestine? We have enough problems in this country. Why should we worry about you? And it's a legitimate question. It's not just about us. Martin Luther King said, at a very basic level, boycott is withdrawing cooperation from an evil system. So India is complicit in maintaining this evil system through military trade and many, many other forms, especially military trade. There's a common interest between the majority of Indians and Palestinians in shifting this country's massive resources from the military buildup, where Israel is profiting tremendously, to social services, employment, the environment, and so on and so forth. We have a common interest in this. It's not just about Palestinian rights.
Let me find someone a bit further back. And
woman with the program over there.
Okay, yes, wait, where?
All the way
there. Oh, there we are. All right, she's wearing a scarf. Is that a scarf?
Holding a program.
Yes. There we are. Try to keep some gender balance here in our questioners.
Hi. This is a wonderful discussion. While I agree with Omar that the international law should be implemented in an objective sense, I was remembering Darwish and what he spoke of memory in terms of reconciliation. So I would just like your comments on that.
Sure. When you are in an oppressed situation, when you're in the oppressed community, the minority, the oppressed by hegemonic power, you have two choices. The law of the jungle or international law. Is international law perfect? Absolutely not. Imperial powers wrote international law to divide the world and protect their interests. We know that. But currently, we only have that as an oppressed community to resort to, the United Nations and international law. But it is not so soft. I mean, they call us soft power. Soft power can be extremely powerful, as Gandhi himself has shown.
All right, where is the microphone? There's a guy right there on the aisle. There he is. No, I'm pointing at you, don't turn around. There we are.
Good afternoon, ma'am. My question is for Madam Laleh. Ma'am, you mentioned some very serious human rights issues in Gaza, like forced starvation and the laboratory testing of defense technologies. My question is that it is understandable that countries of the world can have their strategic interests in keeping Israel happy. But shouldn't this particular topic of serious human rights violations be considered very serious after what we have seen in the world, like Holocaust and colonialism? And it is not something too old also. It is just about 60 or 70 years old.
Well, so I suppose this question echoes the one that was just asked to Omar in a sense, which is kind of, why does international law not take account of?
I think it's really important to note two things. One, that there have been repeated United Nations, at least General Assembly, intervention, which in some senses speaks for the larger part of the world. It's also important to note that everything, including international law and human rights organizations, tend to be very political and tend to be driven by politics. So Human Rights Watch, for example, can go on ahead and issue a report which, before it ever sees the light of day, has had loads of intervention by Human Rights Watch donors, by lobby groups, which soften the language against Israel. It's a political thing. When the Goldsmith Report, which was an independent commission to study the 2008-2009 Israeli assault on Gaza, was issued, Goldsmith was submitted to the most outrageous personal attacks. Again, it's a political thing, and so in some senses, although we can speak about the memories of injustices that were done, not just in the Holocaust, but as much more recently in many more in many different parts of the world. Nevertheless, when it comes down to the brass tacks, ultimately what matters, I think, is you say international law, I say political pressure. And I think that international law won't come about
Absolutely.
Being implemented
Absolutely.
Without there being massive political pressure, not just in Israel, Palestine, but also everywhere else.
International law does not have feet. We have to be its feet.
I'm going to take one more question, and then I'm going to put a final question to everyone. There's a woman wearing sunglasses right there. I'm pointing at you, yes. The sunglasses are on your head, admittedly, not on your eyes. But.
Okay, so I may be a little flawed in my understanding here, but the point is the Palestinian issue has always been combined with some larger issue, whether it's Arab identity or it's non-aligned movement. And as soon as those issues got redundant, the Palestinian issue was dropped by the international community. So do you think it has come to its own now with so many changes happening? So the 2011 Arab uprisings once again raised the issues of identity, Iran coming into the international community for such a long time. Do you think it's going to be focused on as a Palestinian issue rather than some larger, broad question we are looking at the Middle East?
Exactly the opposite. Instead of just being, it's definitely an Arab issue, a Middle Eastern issue, but it's becoming a universal issue again. As Laleh said, that's how it was. Today, Professor John Dugard, international law expert from South Africa, says Palestinian rights are becoming the litmus test for international human rights. The global South is watching. If the world fails to hold up Palestinian rights, then no one has hope, because the injustice is so clear in your face.
And I want to say one more thing about that. There's also been the Palestinian people now have had generations of artists and writers writing about that. And I cannot emphasize enough the role that these artists and writers and filmmakers have played in actually making the Palestinian cause not only a singularly important one, but one that is situated in a larger global space.
This is a perfect segue into my final question for the group, which not everyone has to answer because I'm putting you on the spot. We have this very attentive audience. If you were going to send them off to read one book about Gaza, to watch one film about Gaza, to look at a novel that takes place in Gaza, what would you say to all of these people? This is what you should go off and read.
There is an extraordinary book by a Gazan journalist called The Drone Eats With Me. It's an account of life under Operation Protective Edge, of the surveillance of the death. It reminds me of if Goya, instead of being an artist, a visual artist, was a writer and he had written the horrors of war.
You too, anything?
I suggest after reading about Gaza, do something about it. Open bdsmovement.net. Uh-huh. Join our movement.
You are.
And I suggest two books by Mahmoud Darwish, none of them about Gaza, but which are both relevant. One is called Memory for Forgetfulness, one of the most beautiful books ever written about anything, which is about the Israeli siege of Beirut in 1982, and another book of poetry called State of Siege, which is about the Israeli siege of West Bank, because in some senses it just repeats the fact, it just emphasizes the fact that Israel continuously engages in this policy of siege, and it has done so over the entirety of its history.
All right, thank you very much, everyone.